non-communicable diseases. This is a slide actually downloaded from the internet from WHO. This is specifically looking at non-communicable disease profile 2014 for Uganda. So it basically shows that this is the slice of the pie that is actually taken off by non-communicable disease. So we'll say about 25% at this point in time. Still a large component is from communicable diseases. But this is an ever-growing slice as percentage of mortality. Next slide. When you look at prevalences of non-communicable diseases over time, we are going to look at four non-communicable diseases in particular. We're going to look at cardiovascular, chronic respiratory diseases, cancer, and diabetes. Those are the ones we are going to discuss for the purposes of this presentation. Well, this is a slide showing their progress from 2020. This is a very important, biggest data for this number. And look at age-adjusted death rate of 100,000. It's clear that particularly for cardiovascular diseases, the other thing is that the bold lines are males and the dotted lines are female. This is cardiovascular, this is the big cause cancer, and then this is a combination of diabetes and chronic respiratory diseases for both males and females. So it's clear that we have fairly, in terms of mortality rates, we are really looking at cardiovascular diseases fairly high up there and lower there, but creeping over time. We don't necessarily very huge changes over time with these particular diseases. I was looking for data on what to present in this particular meeting, but I landed on to the preliminary analysis of the National Risk Factor Survey, which has just been concluded in 2014. This is a national population-based survey for Uganda, looking at the risk factors for non-communicable disease. One of the biggest risk factors for non-communicable disease is BMI, body mass index. And from this national survey, I've decided to actually look at urban and rural and then make the case that urbanization is increasing and therefore these factors are about to increase over time. But when you look at BMI, less than 25 is normal, between 25 and 30 really is overweight, and over 30 is actually obese, classified as obese. Looking at the rural and urban stratification, this is for both male and female. Had data for male and female, but I felt I should go for rural urban stratification. It's very clear when you look at these two, obese and overweight, it's very clear that it is significantly higher in urban setting. Okay, next, when we look at fasting blood plasma glucose, we have a measure of less than 25, 29, and 30. No, this is BMI. Okay, this is BMI, this is in a different BMI category, and fasting blood glucose, as expected, you find that it's more in the urban centers. Urban people who live in urban centers are having somewhat higher fasting blood sugars. Next coming. Then when we look at blood pressure, normal hypertension, pre-hypertensive hypertension, you find that there is a difference. That difference though is not statistically significant. I know Kasasa is in the audience, between urban and rural. Between these two, which was quite a bit of a surprise before the urban and rural stratification for blood pressure. Next slide. Physical activity, as you can imagine. Physical activity is looking at urban and rural. Physical activity is a way of life in rural areas, right? But in urban, you notice that it is slightly lower.
That difference is actually significantly.
It's significant.
Next. So, when you look at those underlying risk factors, compared with, and also put in mind that urbanization is really increasing. This is a very interesting statistic by Frost and Silver, who actually think that by 2050, 60% of the African population is actually being urban. And that means that the risk factors for the underlying cardiovascular diseases are going to be higher, and therefore we expect this to be a problem moving forward. Next. So, we do know there's increasing urbanization. I will summarize on the non-communicable. Prevalence of NCD risk factor is going to increase over time with urbanization, and therefore as risk factors change. There's a need to have good data on incidence and prevalence of non-communicable diseases. That's one of the things that is extremely very important moving forward. And I'll make a point that it's very important for planning. Cost of management of this disease therefore will increase. As the prevalence does increase, it's very important in our universal, to put in mind in our universal care coverage. Next, so let's look at emerging and re-emerging infectious diseases. Well, I want you to bear in mind two factors that actually are huge drivers for these emerging and re-emerging. The population is actually increasing tremendously. Anybody who lives in Uganda knows that there's a huge population pressure. Our last national survey now indicates, Fred, what is the population now for Uganda? About 36. So we really think that this is going to be a huge factor, not only in the cost of universal primary care, but also for drivers of many health problems. So next. Population growth is going to be a huge driver of human activities, accessing land. Next, urbanization is going to be a huge factor in the rate and speed at which infectious disease actually spread. Next, political instability is also going to be a huge factor in brewing up infections and destabilizing population. Next, all these will cascade to actually emerge of these non-zoonotic diseases. So we have seen in Uganda, Marburg, Ebola, and what this does to masking or unmasking poor health systems. But that's going to be a huge problem moving forward. Remember, next, that even in addition to these new emerging diseases, HIV infection is going to still be with us. When you look at this graph, when you look at new infection, this Ministry of Health graph for data up to 2014, new infections, net increase on people on ART, estimated mortality, everything here means that when you look at the blue lines, HIV infected people are coming down the line, and therefore there's going to be a need for treatment. Also, eventually, there's going to be lot of age-related morbidity, and mortality. That's a huge burden. Let's give you an idea. Next slide. This is a study from the work we did looking at the future of HIV in Uganda, in Africa, and the needs for care. This shows you that the projected cost of the number of people in treatment and the cost, that is the total number of ART. We have talked of first line and second line. But look at the number of total cost. It's going to cascade up. And we are talking about millions of US dollars in the future. It's going to be a huge cost in terms of caring these individuals. So HIV will still be in the background for a long time. Next. What about the new emerging disease? I mean, the already existing disease. Drug resistance is a big factor in really making these diseases not go away. When I was in the medical school, we used to talk of health for all by year 2000. You remember that slogan? We should have said health for all in 2,000 years. But at that time, we actually thought we were going to eradicate malaria. Okay? But look, drug resistance is going to be a huge question. And we have to factor this looking at our disease values. Why? These are some of the issues about drug resistance. When you look at malaria, next slide, drug resistance is a huge problem in areas all around equatorial Africa. When you look at TB, next slide, TB and drug resistance is going to be, drug resistance for TB, mount. You know one thing that makes me sweat at night? Is MDR-TB. If it really creeps up, as it is going to, it will be a huge game changer on how we are going to manage the cost implications of TB. We do know we do have it, and with this population pressure, talking about urbanization, overcrowding, it's a very good recipe for a widespread of MDR-TB moving forward. This is going to change the way we look at treatment of TB and what it's going to cost. Next slide. So, the primary drivers of emergence of spread of zoonotic diseases are already in place, they're in play. So we should expect this to happen. HIV infection will continue to be a major public health problem, and its cost over time is going to be huge. Remember, the denominator is changing. Drug resistance, malaria, tuberculosis, particularly tuberculosis, is going to be both causes of mortality, causes of mortality and morbidity in Africa. Cost management of disease will increase as the drugs are expensive. Come online. So, what is its implication on the health system? Because now you go to the implication of the health system, and then you say, look, can we now provide universal health care given that background scenario? So, the first thing is the lack of human resource. I don't need to labor this point. But more so, the next slide. Are we really training the specialists and the treatment facilities that we need? In the next 50 years, I have a lady here from International Planning. If in the next 20 years, how many of you hands up has had a friend, a brother, a sister going out for treatment on heart-related problems? Hands up. That's the story. Everybody has a heart problem. It keeps going out. We used to go to South Africa. We came too expensive. But are we planning? What is our plan in the next 50 years to try to have the right categories of specialists, have them in a training program now to produce the necessary number, and also have the infrastructure being systematically being put in place to address this problem. And you get a feeling that that is in place. Cardiovascular diseases are coming down on us. Next, reference laboratories, emerging threats, early identification. Is extremely very important. You know how it took so long for people in Liberia to know they have an Ebola epidemic. And when you find out you have to fly samples all over the place to make a diagnosis, is our infrastructure able to meet the challenges, the future challenges and the current challenges? Next. Increased demand for beds. Remember, the population is growing huge. The denominator is becoming huge. You know, we have the health centers to be able to meet those people who are coming down the road. Next, remember, there are also epidemics, both chronic epidemics like HIV and emerging threat epidemics like Ebola. That in itself has a huge impact on healthcare workforce. In terms of healthcare workers and loss of productivity and good performance. That goes back to our production. I can tell you though, there's a very interesting study if you didn't know. Next slide. Traditional healers and herbalists are really in good business in Uganda. They are booming because of lack. They are trying to fill space that is not actually. So is this where we think we should have our universal care coverage from? Do you know 25% of Ugandans first see a herbalist or a tradition for their health problem? Did you know that statistics? So we need to think about that. Next, what are the challenges and the opportunities? If that's my next. I really think there's lack of good data on trends of risk factors, NCDs and key communicable diseases. The data for this needs to be to come out. And there's lack of good data on prevalences of NCDs because many of these NCDs need diagnosis. You need to diagnose the cancer, you need to diagnose the cardiac procedure. You need to have a very good health centers to be collecting this data over time. We have lack of data on costing of interventions. What does it cost? On every particular line in health. If you look at the 10 million costs and you're trying to provide health care, what is it actually costing? Thus, we lack a good sound basis on modeling the future projection of value of this disease and its management. When we are talking universal care coverage, and we're talking of malaria, talking about TB, what is our expenditure per individual now? What will it be in the next 10 to 15 years? What money do we need to be able to make? So, next slide. This is important. This is the basis for future estimation of human resource needs, quantity, and cadres. The infrastructure need, the current and projected cost of interventions, and therefore budgeting. And therefore, talking about universal care coverage, we really need to talk about what it will cost. We need that to really make sure that we are able to know what we are talking about. There are opportunities. One of the things that we have seen in Uganda, and that has kept the School of Public Health very busy, is the thriving numbers of population-based surveys. Data I've talked about is actually from the NCB risk assessment survey, which has just finished. So public health was involved. We always have VHS surveys. We now need to sort of the VHS survey now is becoming a vehicle for collecting a whole host of other data. And burden of disease surveys are about to start. We have just finished the tuberculosis survey. It's a nationwide survey to look at prevalences of TB. But one thing that is very important is DNA-based technologies has helped us to make diagnosis, which would have needed huge laboratory infrastructure. But actually, we can now do it very simply. That will give us an idea patterns of disease, incidence, and prevalences, and be able to have better estimates of this population, the diseases in the population. Next, the other thing is actually African economies are growing, irrespective of what you hear. There's a very strong GDP, 5 to 6%. So there's some increase in income over time. In fact, a recent economist, if you want to know how a country is doing, it's the BBC. Beer, BBC, it was C is for cement, or banks, breweries, banks, and cement. If those are really going up in a country, it's really doing well, for lack of other data. But the economies are growing. So what next? It's the leadership. African leaders said, you know, we have this Abidjan declaration. Many are not. I was just telling my friend here from the EPA, National Planning, NPA. You see, as a student, yes, it does teach strategic planning. But there's one thing I learned from strategic planning. Show me your budget. I'll write you the strategic plan. So if you think health, if you look at Uganda's budget, would you say health is a huge priority? Because even we can't meet the Abuja Declaration in Uganda, and by the way, that is the budget, that is the estimated expenditure. The real expenditure is even much less. So the investment is not there at this point. While the denominator is growing, threats are growing, and you can see the balance. Next and last slide. So we need to leave leadership and accountability to be sure. In terms of this universal care coverage, it's a huge leadership issue in any country. Have you seen what it has taken Obama for just doing a little bit? You know, it is just a huge problem. So we need to commit the resources. You can talk prioritizing health, but your budget has to reflect it. Make sure that we take that leadership. So I hope I haven't discouraged you a lot about universal coverage, but I really think I've put the whole discussion in perspective in terms of moving forward. Thank you for listening.